Hello my dear students, in previous video we learn about cell, discovery of cell, unicellular and multicellular organisms. We learn that cell is basic fundamental unit of life. As all organisms are made up of cell and cell perform certain functions which are important for life, so cell is known as structural and functional unit of life. Also we learn that cell has special components called cell organelles and each organelle performs specific function, so cell is able to live. Students, if we observe cell under microscope, we are able to see three components in almost every cell, and those are cell membrane, nucleus and cytoplasm. So today we are going to learn about these components of cell and also about cell wall. Plasma membrane, also called as cell membrane or cytoplasmic membrane. It is outermost covering of cell that separates cell contents from external environment. It is living part of cell, present in all cells. It is thin, delicate, elastic, selectively permeable, microscopic and regenerative layer. Regenerative means if it get damaged then it can be regenerate. Microscopic, we can't see it with our naked eyes, but we can observe it through electron microscope. Selectively permeable means it allows selective substances to come inside the cell and to go out of the cell. For example, if this is the cell, this layer, these are different organelles of the cell, and this layer is plasma membrane. So this outermost layer is plasma membrane, and it is selectively permeable, means it allows selected substances such as oxygen to move inside the cell, carbon dioxide to move out of the cell, water and molecules, different molecules, glucose to go inside the cell. But it will not allow cell organelles or cytoplasm of the cell to come out of the cell. And so it is called as selectively permeable, means it permits entry and exit of some materials to come inside the cell, to enter inside the cell or to leave the cell. It is composed of lipid and proteins. It is made up of lipids and proteins. It is flexible, so enables cell to engulf food. For example, amoeba, which is a unicellular organism, how it captures the food? Amoeba forms temporary finger-like projection to capture the food from external environment. And that finger-like projection, called as pseudopodia, is formed with the help of this flexible elastic plasma membrane. And so this plasma membrane is flexible, enables cell to engulf the food from outer environment, and this process is called as endocytosis. If we observe plasma membrane under microscope, you will observe this structure. This is the structure of plasma membrane. It is made up of phospholipid bilayer. Bi means two. So here we can observe the two layers of lipids. Now we will see functions of plasma membrane. It is selectively permeable membrane, so it allows the flow of limited substances in and out of cell, such as it allows oxygen to come into the cell, as carbon dioxide is the waste of cell, waste generated in the cell. It allows carbon dioxide to move out of the cell. It permits entry of water and glucose into the cell. Protection of cell body and giving the cell a definite shape. As it is outermost layer, it protects the internal cell organelles and gives shape to the cell. Transportation of different materials inside and outside the cell. Students, now we will understand how transport of substances takes place through plasma membrane. As plasma membrane is selectively permeable, Substances can pass through plasma membrane by two processes, diffusion and osmosis. Students, you know about diffusion. We learn it in lesson number 1. It is the process of movement of substances from a region of high concentration to the region of low concentration due to uniform spreading of molecules. So whenever there is difference in concentration of particles, so for one side if particle is more in one part, then from that part particles will move to the other region where the concentration of particle is less. The particles may be of solid, liquid or gas. In cell also, during cellular respiration, carbon dioxide accumulates in high concentration as cellular waste in the cell, and concentration of oxygen in external cellular environment is low. So carbon dioxide moves out of cell from high concentration to low concentration by the process of diffusion. For example, this is cell. In this cell, carbon dioxide is formed in the form of waste. When the concentration of this carbon dioxide is more inside the cell as compared to outside the cell, then carbon dioxide will move from high concentration to low concentration. That means it will come out of the cell by the process of diffusion. Similarly, when we inhale air, concentration of oxygen is more outside the cell and low inside the cell. And then oxygen moves in the cell from outer environment of cell through plasma membrane by the process of diffusion. Thus, diffusion plays important role in gaseous exchange between cell as well as cell and its outer environment. Another process is osmosis. It is the process of movement of water from its high concentration region to its low concentration region through semi-permeable membrane. See, here semi-permeable membrane is required. Semi-permeable membrane means the membrane through which certain molecules or ions can pass by diffusion. Our plasma membrane is semi-permeable. It is selectively permeable also and semi-permeable also, because it can pass certain molecular size substances through it. In cell, transport of water is carried out by the process of osmosis from high concentration to low concentration. It is special case of diffusion. Osmosis takes place only in the liquid medium. We can observe diffusion in solid, in liquid and in gases. But the rate of diffusion is more in gaseous substance than as compared to liquid and solid. But osmosis takes place only in liquid medium. It involves movement of solvent molecule only. So in osmosis, solvent molecule moves from higher concentration to low concentration. In cell, water is the solvent, or water is known as universal solvent of life, as it is able to transport chemicals, minerals and nutrients essential for life. So in cell, osmosis is the process for the movement of water through plasma membrane. Students, what will happen if we put cell in sugar solution? One of the following three things could happen. If the solution is hypotonic solution, means having more concentration of solvent or water in it than the cell, then the cell will gain water by osmosis, and such dilute solution is called as hypotonic solution. So the dilute solution which is having more concentration of water is called as hypotonic solution. If we will put cell in the hypotonic solution, then cell will gain the water because water will move from high concentration to low concentration. Though water molecules are free to pass across plasma membrane in both the sides, but more water will enter inside the cell and the cell will swell up and increase in volume. This process is called endosmosis. For example, this is a beaker filled with water, filled with sugar solution, hypotonic solution, that is dilute solution, in which very small amount of sugar is there and more amount of water is there. If we put any cell in this solution, the cell water will move from high concentration to low concentration. Water will move inside the cell and cell will swell up, it will increase in volume, and this process is called as endosmosis, and that dilute solution is called as hypotonic solution. Another type of solution is isotonic solution. If the medium surrounding the cell is of exactly the same water concentration as inside the cell, means if concentration of water in the cell and in the solution is same, then there will be no net movement of water across membrane, resulting in no change in size of cell. If the solution is isotonic solution having same concentration, then cell will remain as it is. Another solution is hypertonic solution. If the medium surrounding the cell has lower water concentration, that is, if the solution is highly concentrated, means if the solution is highly concentrated, then the cell will lose water through osmosis. Such concentrated solution is called as hypertonic solution. When water moves out of the cell placed in the highly concentrated solution, it will cause the cell to shrink. And this process is known as exosmosis. The biological phenomenon of exosmosis is known as plasmolysis. Means, see, if beaker is there, in this we have taken the concentrated solution. Concentrated solution means what? Having less water. And this cell is there which is having more water. So, in this solution, water cell will lose water, so water will come out of the cell into the solution, and the size of cell will reduce, the cell will shrink because of loss of water, and this is called as exosmosis. Exo means out, so in this water will move out of the cell, and this exosmosis is called as plasmolysis. Means when the living plant cell lose water through osmosis, there will be shrinkage of cell away from the cell wall takes place. If a plant cell is there and it will lose the water, the cell will move away from the cell wall, and that is known as plasmolysis. So this is the osmosis which we can observe in different solution. Here is the difference between diffusion and osmosis. Diffusion takes place in any medium. Semi-permeable membrane is not required. Diffusing molecules may be of solid, liquid and gases, and it depends on free energy of molecule. Now, osmosis, it takes place only in liquid medium. So, liquid or solution is required because the movement of solvent molecule takes place in osmosis. Semi-permeable membrane is required. It involves movement of solvent molecules only. Only the solvent molecule will move. Here, the diffusion of solvent molecule is affected by presence of other substances in the system. Means presence of solute will affect the rate of diffusion or osmosis. Another organelle is most important organelle, that is nucleus. Nucleus is brain of cell. It controls all cellular activities and function of cell organelles. It is small, round, double membrane organelle. Nucleus is bound by double membrane called nuclear membrane. Nuclear membrane contains pores which allow transfer of materials from nucleus to cytoplasm. See, this is the structure of nucleus. This nucleus is having double membrane. And that double membrane is called as nuclear membrane. And in this nuclear membrane, very small pores are present, small holes are present for the transport of materials from nucleus to cytoplasm because nucleus is present, it is embedded in cytoplasm, and from cytoplasm to nucleus. And so these pores are called as nuclear pores. The fluid present inside the nucleus is called nucleoplasm. Here this fluid is called as nucleoplasm. Nucleus contains entangled mass of thread-like structure called chromatin. So this is entangled thread-like structure is called as chromatin. It exists during resting stage of cell, means cell is not dividing. This chromatin contains DNA, that is deoxyribonucleic acid, RNA, ribonucleic acid and proteins. Nucleus contains chromosomes, which are rod-shaped structure visible when only when cell is about to divide. So when cell is about to divide, that chromatin or that entangled mass converts into rod-like structure called as chromosomes. Chromosomes contains information for inheritance of features from parents to next generation. For example, skin color, color of eyes, etc. It is decided by chromosomes from parents to offspring, and many more hereditary characters also. Chromosomes are composed of DNA and protein. DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. DNA molecules contains information necessary for constructing and organizing the cell. So the construction or organization of cell is carried out, or this information is there in the DNA. Functional segment of DNA is called genes. Genes decide the hereditary characters of that organism. Now we'll see functions of nucleus. Nucleus controls all the metabolic activities of the cell. As I told you, nucleus is the brain of cell. So it controls all the metabolic activities of cell. Nucleus is the storehouse of genes. It is concerned with the transmission of hereditary traits from parents to offspring. So all the hereditary characters are present in the nucleus because it is the storehouse of genes. It plays important role in cellular reproduction. By the process of cell division, the new cell formation, growth, all this is carried out by the nucleus. It plays important role in the cellular reproduction. Next organelle is cytoplasm. When we observe cell mound under microscope, the region which has very little stain is cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is jelly-like, viscous, colorless, semi-fluid substance that occurs between plasma membrane and nuclear membrane. The ground aqueous substance of cytoplasm is called cytosol, in which cell organelles and other insoluble products and products like starch, lipids, etc. remains float. So this fluid like a fluid present between nucleus or nuclear membrane and plasma membrane is called as cytoplasm. Now we'll see functions of cytoplasm. Cytoplasm acts as a store of vital chemicals like amino acids, proteins, sugars and vitamins. All these are important chemicals which are important for the cell and metabolic process of cell. So all those substances are stored in the cytoplasm. It is the site of certain metabolic reactions like glycolysis, synthesis of fatty acids, etc. It provides nutrients and nourishment to all cell organelles. As cell organelles are embedded in the cytoplasm, this cytoplasm provides nutrients and nourishment to all these organelles. Cell wall. Cell wall is non-living, thick and freely permeable covering made up of cellulose in plants, peptidoglycan in bacteria, and cell wall of fungi is made up of chitin. In animal cell, cell wall is absent. Cell wall is present in plant cell and in the cell of bacteria and fungi. This is the diagram of plant cell wall. This outermost structure is the cell wall. within that cell wall, plasma membrane is there, and then other cell organelles. Now we'll discuss functions of cell wall. It determines the shape and rigidity to the plant cell. So as it is made up of cellulose in plants, it is rigid substance, and so it gives specific shape to the plant cell. It protects the plasma membrane. It is outermost layer, so it gives protection to plasma membrane, prevents dryness of cell. It helps in transport of various substance in and out of cell, as it is freely permeable, so it helps in the transport of various substances. It helps cells to withstand much greater changes in surrounding medium than animal cell. For example, if plant cell wall is placed in hypotonic solution. Hypotonic solution means what? The dilute solution in which more water concentration is there. Then the water will move inside the cell and cell will swell up. Then that cell will exert pressure on the cell wall. If we place that plant cell wall in hypotonic solution, the cell will gain water, water will move inside the cell, cell will swell, and it will exert pressure on the cell wall. At the same time, cell wall will exert the pressure on the plasma membrane or on the cell. And so, such cell can withstand greater changes without bursting. Cell will not burst due to the cell wall present around it. But as animal cell is not having cell wall, so in hypotonic solution, animal cell swells up and bursts out due to osmotic pressure. So these are the different organelles and their function. Student, you have to remember the structure and function of different cell organelles. Now we will discuss about prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell. Pro means primitive and karyon means nucleus. So cell having primitive or undeveloped nucleus is called as prokaryotic cell. Prokaryotic cells are cells in which true nucleus is absent. Nuclear region of cell is poorly defined due to absence of nuclear membrane. So prokaryotic cells are primitive cells in which nucleus is not well developed. It is not having the double layer membrane. Nuclear membrane is absent. And undefined nuclear region is present, which contains only nucleic acid. And that poorly defined nucleus is called as nucleoid. In prokaryotic cell, membrane bound organelles are also absent. Prokaryotes are always unicellular organisms, such as archaebacteria, bacteria, blue green algae are all prokaryotes. Another type of cell is eukaryotic cell. Eukaryotic cells are the cells in which true nucleus is present, means the nucleus which is well developed, which is having nuclear membrane, that those cells are called as eukaryotic cells. They are advanced and complete cells. Eukaryotes include all living organisms. So in this we can see some unicellular organisms also and all multicellular organisms except bacteria and blue green algae. Eukaryotic organisms having nuclear membrane and all organelles are also membrane bound. So we can say it is a complex or developed cells as compared to prokaryotic cells. See, this is the diagram of prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. Difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Most prokaryotes are unicellular organisms, whereas eukaryotes are multicellular and unicellular both. The nucleus in prokaryotes is poorly defined due to absence of nuclear membrane. So in prokaryotes, nucleus is poorly defined, not having nuclear membrane. In eukaryotes, the nucleus is well defined and is surrounded by nuclear membrane. Nucleolus is absent in prokaryotes, nucleolus is present in eukaryote. Nucleolus is the dense spherical structure in the nucleus, and it is important for making proteins. It plays important role in making proteins, that we will learn. So such nucleolus is absent in prokaryotes, present in eukaryotes. Cell organelles such as plastid, mitochondria, Golgi bodies are absent in prokaryotes, as it is primitive, undeveloped cell. So most of the cell organelles are absent in it. All cell organelles are present in the eukaryotes, as it is a complex cell. Example of prokaryotes are bacteria, blue-green algae, and example of eukaryotes is fungi, plant, and animal cells. Students, I think you understood today's topic. Thank you and have a nice day.